I'm going to talk a little bit about what we're doing in Britain. I'm not quite sure whether it's health reform and the economy, but it's health change in the economy anyway. The population of Britain is 61 million, $35,000 GDP per capita. We're borrowing far too much money. Actually, our healthcare expenditure is not $108 billion, that's pounds, so it's about $160 billion per year. Every country spends what it can on healthcare, but the amount it spends varies very considerably, and this just shows what's available, for what is spent on healthcare in the EOCD countries. And you can see that right at the far right is you guys, spending much more healthcare per capita than anyone else in God's earth. And what can be cost effective in the United States and Norway and Switzerland can't necessarily be cost effective and affordable in Mexico and Poland and the Slovak Republic on the left hand side. The reason why countries vary so widely is because how rich they are. And there's a remarkable linear relationship, or at least roughly linear, between a company's GDP and the amount of money they spend on healthcare. And it's extraordinary how close this relationship is, bearing in mind the dissimilarities in the way healthcare systems are funded. There are two outliers. At the extreme right is Luxembourg, which could spend more on healthcare. It's a bit complicated because, of course, Luxembourg is very small, and most of its healthcare is provided by Belgium. And then there's one at the top, up at the top there, and I'll leave you to guess which country seems to be spending more on healthcare than, by most standards, it can afford. The British National Health Service provides between 92 and 95% of all healthcare in Britain. It was founded in 1948, and it provides care from the cradle to the grave, or the womb to the tomb. It is financed by general taxation, and every year Parliament votes a sum of money to the Department of Health to spend on healthcare. It's a fixed budget. It cannot overrun. And the Department of Health distributes much of that money to 150 what we call primary care trusts, which are responsible for disbursing money with contracts to hospital services and to general practitioner services. NICE, the organization that was set up 10 or 11 years ago, provides advice to the Department of Health, primary care trusts, and to its service providers, both in general practice and in hospitals. We are about though, to undergo a change, and we have a new administration in Britain, and the Parliament will still continue to vote money for healthcare, which will go to a newly renamed Department of Public Health. And the day-to-day running of the health service will become the responsibility of something called the National Health Service Commissioning Board. The decisions about contracts with hospitals will be undertaken by a new body, a group of bodies called GP Commissioning Consortia, made up of general practitioners who commission most hospital services. Some hospital services, the very rarer types of things, will be commissioned centrally. And the commissioning board will commission GP services across the country. NICE will continue to exist and will be giving advice to the Department of Public Health as to whether the other parts of the health service itself. Now, over the years, the expenditure on the British National Health Service has increased, and over the last 10 years or so, it's increased extraordinarily, almost doubled in real terms. And whether that money has been wisely spent is a subject of a lot of argument and discussion. Certainly, the outputs haven't really matched the inputs. Nevertheless, that increased expenditure is there. But what of the future? Because Britain, as I'm sure you're aware, is facing very difficult financial challenges. We will owe something like 1.3 or 1.4 trillion pounds by 2015. Just servicing our debt is going to cost us 60 billion pounds a year, half the total of the health service. And so what's going to happen to healthcare? Well, Last year, the Institute of Fiscal Studies projected the NHS's financial future. This is the rise between 2006-2010, and they projected three scenarios. One where there was a 2% growth, what they call tepid. One that assumed no growth, which they called cold. And the third, which was a reduction in expenditure by 2 or 3%, which they described as Arctic. Now, in looking at these financial projections, there's also the demographic challenge. The government actuary in Britain estimates that over the next 7 or 8 years, the population will grow by 6.3%. More difficult for the healthcare system is that the age composition will also change with a substantial increase in older people who will make their increasing demands on our healthcare system. So the Institute for Fiscal Studies looked at what might be the funding gap under the tepid scenario, under the cold scenario, and under the Arctic scenario. Even cold is going to cause a problem because of the demographic challenge. In actual fact, the new administration, when it was seeking power, the Conservative Party, said that it would not, it would increase funding of the NHS year by year if it was returned to office, if it was formed the government. And of course, what that means is you only got to give a pound extra a year and you've met your election commitment. 2 days ago, the Chancellor of the Exchequer announced that the health service would have an increase in money of 0.1%, which is probably the smallest amount you can decently offer as an annual increase. So it'll run to about 100 million on a 100 billion pound annual budget. So we are planning in the health service to try and produce savings of around about 10 to 20 billion pounds a year, partly to take into account the demographic challenge, but also to take into account the potential new innovations that we would want to introduce. We want to introduce, extend our screening programs, for example. We'd want to do much more for the health of children. Infant mortality rates in Britain are only marginally better than yours over here, and very marginally. And in Britain, compared to Finland, say, we lose 3 in every 1,000 babies in the first year of life, most of them from unnecessary causes. We should be putting money into those sort of things. So we, improving quality and saving money, we have sort of two sorts of initiatives. There's quite a bit of overlap between them, as I will explain, between national initiatives and ones that NICE is doing. But so some of the national initiatives. We have instituted an arrangement in Britain for the last few years. We've copied your DRG system, HRGs, and we couldn't call it the same thing, so we call it payment by results, which is a slightly odd way of putting it, because it's not payment by results, it's actually payment by procedure. But there is a tariff now that is used throughout the National Health Service. We have instituted some program budgeting arrangements. I think it's probably rather crude still, but I'll just give you a bit of a look at that. About 4 years ago, we set up something called Quality and Outcomes Framework, also known as the QOF, and I'll talk about that. I'll talk about CEQIN. I'm sorry about these terrible abbreviations, but Commissioning for Quality and Innovation. I don't know who invents these terms. And then QIP, Quality, Innovation, Productivity, and Prevention. Program budgeting, primary care trusts are now required to look at their expenditure, both in primary care, general practice, and in hospital care, over various programs of care, from hearing on the left to mental health on the right. This is the average expenditure per head per year for 2006-2007. You can see there are very considerable differences, as you might expect, of course. Mental health being actually one of the most, being in almost every PCT, the biggest consumer of money. The point of this, of course, is that PCTs are encouraged to, when they're looking to see where they can disinvest or whether they need to put more investment in, to use this sort of program budgeting data in order to make more rational decisions. It is, of course, very much historical data of where money's been put in the past, not necessarily where money needs to go. But Peter Smith and his colleagues at Imperial College have actually looked to see from the program budgeting the estimated cost per life year gain from these various programs. And he estimates that it's relatively modest for respiratory disease on the left of about £7,000 per life year gain to about £25,000 per life year gain in diabetes. We spend a lot of money on diabetic care compared to circulatory disease or malignant disease. So that's program budgeting. The second program is the quality and outcomes framework. This is a program that was set up about 4 years ago. And it rewards general practitioners, family doctors, for achieving certain targets. And there are indicators in these three areas. The clinical indicator, which accounts for about 75% of the points that you can earn. Organizational ones are things like having reasonable waiting times and things like that, and appointment systems. And additional services are things like maternity services, which general practitioners can do if they wish to. But the clinical indicators are the large ones. And so the general practitioners are paid additional money if, for example, 80% of their hypertensive patients are well controlled. We can do this in Britain because our general practice network is very highly computerized. It would be virtually impossible if this wasn't computerized. And so from their computerized electronic medical records, it is very simple for primary care trusts to interrogate their data to find out what proportion of patients they do have well controlled. They get no money for doing cervical smears unless 70% of their eligible patients have smears. Then they get 50% of the rate, and only do they get the full rate if they get 90% smears. Some of the clinical indicators are a bit bizarre. They've got to weigh everybody in their practice every year. What weighing does is unclear unless you actually then lose weight. But if you ask my general practitioner colleagues to weigh everybody in their practice over the age of 18 every year, and you're going to pay them to do it, you'll be very surprised to learn that they do it. So some of these indicators were a little bit odd, but there's no question about it that my colleagues in family practice have risen to the bait, and the amount of money that they've earned extra has increased their salaries by 25 to 30%. Far in excess of what the government expected at the time it instituted this whole scheme. So in some ways it's been successful in that doctors will do what you want them to do if you pay them. May not come as a surprise, but it seems to have surprised some of my colleagues in the Department of Health. And unquestionably it has had some improvement in care. For 2 years ago, though, the government asked NICE to take responsibility for defining the clinical indicators. And so we have, in the process of removing some of the more less sensible indicators and replacing them with ones that are not only effective but also cost-effective. It is all very awkward because these then have to be negotiated with the general practitioners. As you may or may not know, GPs in Britain are not salaried. They're small businesses under contract with the National Health Service, and the contracts have to be negotiated laboriously to get our new indicators in. Nevertheless, we are seeing some change. So although some people are very critical of the quality and outcomes framework, and there are crinkles in it, I think it's actually doing the right thing. The second program, commissioning for quality and innovation, in some respects, I think we've actually probably copied some of the things you've been doing here. The primary care trusts give additional payments now for the last 2 years of now 1.5% of contract income if agreed quality improvements can be shown by providers, particularly in hospitals. There are specified national goals, reduction in venous thrombembolism, and improving response to patients' personal needs. And then locally, there are 3 to 5 specified local goals that providers and PCTs get together and arrange. It's difficult at this stage to know how successful this has been really in improving quality, and we don't really have enough information. And then the third component is the quality, innovation, productivity, and prevention, QIP. It keeps on changing its name, but it's back to QIP again. And there's a whole program of endeavors that are on stream to try and maintain quality, improve innovation, and yet make savings. And I'm not going to go into these. The commissioning pathways are very much in relationship to NICE's guidelines program. There's a whole lot of provider efficiency functions that you can see there, and some system enablers. Which brings me on to NICE and what we're doing. NICE's purpose, we were set up in 1999, and our primary purpose when we were originally established was to try and to provide health professionals with advice on securing the highest attainable standards of care for patients under the National Health Service. Then in 2005, we had additional responsibilities given to us in relationship to the public health. In doing so, right from the very beginning, it was mandated by law that in developing our advice, we had to take into account both clinical effectiveness and cost effectiveness. And as I said, that is enshrined in law. We now have a whole variety of guidance products. Technology appraisals, where we're looking at the clinical and cost effectiveness of new and existing health technologies, and I'll mention that in a moment again. Our clinical guidelines program, I'm going to mention that again in a moment too. We have an interventional procedures program. This is actually licensing, as it were, new interventional procedures. The ingenuity of my surgical colleagues to do clever things in operating theatres knows no bounds. And we've got into trouble in the past when interesting things that they'd read about didn't seem to go quite as well as they expected when they did it in their own hospital. And so this interventional procedures program was established. And it's amazing the number of ways my urological colleagues have devised to remove my prostate brings tears to the eyes. A lot of our technology appraisals have been concerned with pharmaceuticals, and in a few months ago we launched another program looking at medical technology guidance, particularly focusing on devices which we've done little and diagnostics of which we've done virtually none. And that's a new program that's coming on stream now. And then the final bit on our guidance products relates to quality standards. These are derivative from our clinical guidelines, and we started doing them under the previous administration government, and the new administration are extremely keen on our quality standards and want actually to do more of them, and they want about 150 over the next 4 or 5 years. And these quality standards are simple statements, between 6 and 10 statements, about the features of a high-quality service in a particular area. It could be, for example, stroke, which is one of the ones we did a pilot in. And with those quality standards, we will also be producing metrics. And so that not only can local hospitals measure themselves against these standards, but they can be measured against each other and against the country as a whole. We also produce public health guidance products. This is for the wider public health community, and I'm not going to mention it, but it is actually very important. And then the final thing we've done over the last 18 months is to produce something called NHS Evidence. This is a website. It looks rather like Google, it's a quick sort of bit here. It's got that funny iris on the left-hand side, which I never liked. When I was showing this to the president of the Royal Colleges, the president of the Royal College of Ophthalmologists was there, and I said to her, I'm sure there's something wrong with this iris, and she said, it's a perfectly normal one. I think it's rather nice, so that moment I gave up, and the iris is there. Basically what you do is you type in your question, and instead of the problem with Google is if you type in a question, you put hypertension or something, you get 10 million hits and you don't know where to start. NHS Evidence extracts from the World Wide Web and from Guideline and other developers, and it accredits them. Increasingly only accredited organizations are recognized by this portal. You're very welcome to use it. It's all free for anywhere in the world, except you can't get into the British National Formulary for some reason or other. We don't own it, and we can't allow others to have access outside Britain. That did cause me a bit of trouble not long ago when the Surgeon General rang me up and said that the armed forces couldn't get access to it in Afghanistan and Pakistan, and would I do something about it? So I told the producers of the British National Formulary there was an easy way or a hard way. They either lifted the block, or I went to the Daily Mail and told them our boys were suffering. You can imagine what happened. Technology appraisals, this is predominantly pharmaceuticals, but it does include some devices, procedures, and diagnostic techniques. Surprisingly, you may be surprised to learn that actually we say full use of our technology appraisals in two-thirds of the things we look at. Restricted use in 16%, only in research, which is a bit like coverage of evidence development, 6%, and no use in just over 10%. So 90% we say either you say yes or a yes, but. It doesn't seem quite like that when you read the Daily Mail. But we have to do that. Some interventions are too expensive for what benefits they bring. And if we were to provide very expensive interventions for a small number of people, we would deprive many others of cost-effective care. And they're usually, others are usually people without lobby groups, without a powerful voice behind them. And we have to think of everyone in Britain who uses the health service. Our clinical guidelines program, we have adopted the Institute of Medicine's definition of systematically developed statements to assist practitioner and patient decisions about appropriate healthcare for specific clinical circumstances. Our clinical guideline program encompasses both cost effectiveness as well as clinical effectiveness. And it has now grown. We've produced over 120 guidelines, and we've got another 40 or 50 in development. It's something actually I'm particularly proud of because I think it's making a real difference. The technology appraisals and the saying no to Avastin and things like that hits the headlines, but it's our clinical guidelines that are having real traction on the system. When we produce our guidance, we try and fulfill the five criteria. We try and ensure that they're robust. Every guideline, every bit of work we do is based on a full systematic review of the literature. We try and be inclusive. That is to say, everybody who's got a point to make should be allowed to make their point. In other words, everyone must have their say, but they can't all have their way. We try and be as transparent as possible. The reasons why we reach decisions, the methods behind reaching them, and so on are all in the public domain. And very unusually for Britain, our advisory committees meet in public. We don't have a tradition in Britain of public meetings in public, but it's something we do at NICE. The decisions are not made by me, they're made by the independent members of our advisory groups. And they are mainly drawn from the health service itself, on our guideline groups, on our appraisal committees and so on. Of course, we have some statisticians and health economists as well, but they are all drawn from the health service. And finally, contestability, that is to say, there must be some mechanism, and there always is, whereby people who are aggrieved by the decisions can have an opportunity to shout foul and have some reconsideration. Our clinical evaluation is based predominantly on randomized controlled trials, but we do use observational studies. And we avoid these wretched hierarchies of evidence that various people in the evidence-based movement have constructed. I dislike them intensely. They are intellectually flawed, and they are potentially very dangerous. It's the economic evaluation that is more complicated in many ways. We have to have three underlying principles. First is we look at the economic perspective. Our economic perspective that we take is that of the National Health Service and something that we call the personal social services, which is basically nursing homes. We do not take a public sector or societal economic perspective. We don't do it actually quite simply because we're not allowed to. Our statutory instruments say that we have to limit our perspective. We could broaden it, and some countries, of course, do, but we are limited to that. And the reason why we're limited is actually because we have delegated powers from the Secretary of State for Health, and he only has powers in relationship to the NHS and personal social services budget. We're looking at cost effectiveness. We're not looking at affordability or budgetary impact. We are specifically excluded from taking those into consideration. And we have to try and balance efficiency and fairness. We have to try and weigh the utilitarian approach to the egalitarian approach. It's not easy. Neither approach on its own is appropriate, and we have to, as one of my colleagues put it, muddle through elegantly. We try and develop our guidance on the basis of our economic analysis on the basis of cost-utility analysis, looking at the costs and savings, both direct and indirect, and looking at the benefits in terms of the improvement in the health-related quality of life, the utility, multiplied by the time for which it's enjoyed. And just to give you an example in order to estimate the incremental cost-effectiveness ratio. So just to give you an example, this is osteoarthritis of the hip. There's someone with a rotten OA hip, and then everything's better with a new one put in. Let's just say that the hip replacement costs £5,000. There's some savings. You don't need to take any of those nasty non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs over the next 15 years, which is your likely longevity. And then, so the net costs over that period of time are £3,500. The benefits we express in terms of utility, where zero means dead, one means full health. So if you have your hip replaced, let's say you increase your utility by 0.3, which means your benefits are 0.3, which you enjoy for 15 years, so you derive 4.5 qualies, and you then calculate the incremental cost-effectiveness ratio, the cost divided by the quali, £778 per quali. Very simple, really. The health economists make it much more complicated. They do things like discounting and all sorts of things. But the principles are perfectly acceptable and straightforward. There are criticisms of this approach. It does indeed fail to capture some elements of improved health-related quality of life, and we have to be very conscious of that. The second problem is it's been claimed to disadvantage the elderly. It doesn't. In actual fact, every time we've used it and used it to look at the elderly, it's actually advantaged the elderly. It takes too narrow an economic perspective. Well, it doesn't necessarily have to, but it does, and of course, from our point of view, we are legally obliged to it. And then the final problem, which is the one that bedevils all these sort of things, is where do you put the threshold between cost-effectiveness and cost-ineffectiveness? This sort of a threshold approach, I sort of look at rather like this. As some of you may know, I'm a pharmacologist, clinical pharmacologist by background, and so I adore dose sigmoid-shaped dose response curves, and it always seemed to me that the whole health economics could be explained with this sort of way. And the critical point, or where one puts the inflections at A and B. And we put it at around about $30,000 per quali. We would regard that, anything less than that, as being good value, cost effective. Above that, there's an increasing likelihood of rejection, particularly above £45,000 per quali. We have gone higher than that. We actually have gone up to about £90,000 per quali at the extreme, but that was on one occasion only for special reasons. And so the point I'm trying to make is that these decisions about where you draw the line involve two sorts of judgments. They involve social value judgments and scientific judgments. The scientific judgments are how good is the database, the appropriateness of subgroups, how generalizable is the results of the trials, and so on and so forth. But there's a second group of judgments that have to be made, social value judgments about severity of the disease, about whether you give special priority to end-of-life interventions, whether extending life by 2 or 3 months is something very precious. What we do about age? Do you have different thresholds for different age groups? What about health inequalities? Now, the people who serve on our committees are good, we hope, at the scientific judgments, but they have no particular legitimacy on the social value judgments. And so in order to capture social value judgments, we've set up something we call a Citizens Council, which are a group of ordinary people, none of them anything to do with healthcare. Broadly speaking, they represent the UK population. And we ask them questions about this, not specific ones related to individual products, but things like age. We value very much their input. And they reflect the views of the public as a whole in our healthcare system. The healthcare system is owned by the public. They pay for it through their taxes. And so we do say yes to things above £30,000 per quali. And this is just some examples here. particularly for severe diseases, really ill for amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, where we accepted £40,000 per quali because of the severity and because also it represented a significant innovation. Pemetrexed for mesothelioma, an industrial disease largely due to asbestos exposure in the 1950s, and severity and significant innovation. We also felt that we had some sort of perhaps some obligation in relationship to the shipyard workers. And so you can see other sort of examples. The point I'm trying to make here is that these decisions at the end of the day are judgmental. We can't escape the fact that we have to make scientific judgments and social value judgments. The important thing is that they are seen by everybody as to what they are, judgments. In other words, we're very explicit. And I rather like this quotation from William Blake, the poet and artist, "God forbid that truth should be confined to mathematical demonstration." Thank you very much indeed.
Can you comment just for a second about the role of health insurance outside of the NHS and how that relates?
Sorry, how about?
As you become stricter, as some of your talk may suggest, if you're Arctic or cold or something, how the pressure that generates might be felt in coverage and other types of system things outside of the NHS?
Well, the consequence of protecting the NHS budget, which is a very large component, a very significant component of the government expenditure, is that the hit on other government departments has been very, very substantial. And some government departments have had 20-30% reductions in expenditure imposed on them. And it's going to be very painful indeed. There's a whole lot of social security programs that are going to be abandoned. I myself, I think, would not have protected the National Health Service in the way that the Conservatives have done. I can understand why they did it, but I would not have probably done it myself that way. It's really having a bad effect. Universities are losing their teaching income by about 45%.
I think the question was about the use of private health care.
Oh, private health, sorry.
Outside the NHS.
Oh, yes. Actually, private health care has had a bit of a bashing in the last few years. Private health care was predominantly elective surgery, cataracts, hip replacements, knee replacements, at a time when the waiting list was so long. As a result of the increased investment over the last 10 years, waiting lists have tumbled, and so the demand for private care, private elective surgery, has dropped very substantially. And of course, that's really all it is. I mean, there aren't any private ERs in Britain. You know, they're all NHS facilities, and so the private sector is pretty modest, and I think it'll remain that way. What will happen, though, I think, is that the new government will allow private providers to provide care for NHS patients. It's been done a little bit in the last few years, and I think that will increase, so that instead of always contracting with NHS hospitals, private providers, independent providers, will be able to bid, as it were, for NHS business.
You mentioned the 30,000 to 45,000 pounds per quali as the...
Well, that's dollars.
Oh, those are dollars.
It's okay. 20 to 13 pounds, but anyway.
Okay.
Yep.
I mean, clearly those don't come from some mathematical formula that's eternally true. And in fact, I've always been frustrated by the fact that in the U.S. context, we're still stuck at $50,000 per quali is a number that keeps popping up, even though it originally was designed in the 1970s to deal with a government kidney program.
Yes, I was reading, yes. Yeah.
And it's still there. And health economists that have looked at these thresholds, many of them have come to the conclusion that something like 3 times GDP per capita would be a better threshold for And that's certainly a lot higher than what you're using in the UK. Can you tell me how the UK came up?
Yeah, yes, I mean, you're quite right. We had several meetings of health economists, workshops, asking them how to find out, how to work it out. And the whole every time it's ended up in disarray. They can't agree amongst themselves as to the way to do it. You know, it's the willingness to pay lot, there's the program budgeting lot, and so on and so forth. From us point of view, it sort of emerged over the first few years. And this was, you know, largely the judgment of the health economic community about what was and what wasn't likely to have an unacceptable opportunity cost. But it does coincide with one or two other things. It's not too far removed from what the threshold is used by, in Britain, the Department of Transport into transport initiatives, which has been looked at fairly carefully in relationship to willingness to pay. And it's you know, about £1.5 million per life saved, which equates roughly, if you take, you know, you have to make a bit of extrapolation, about £30,000 per life again. It's not too far away from what's used by the Health and Safety Executive in Britain. It is somewhat less than what is used by the Home Office, we think, although they're a little bit shy about admitting it, who have a rather higher threshold. But then maybe society wants to pay more for security on the streets, you know, the police force and things like that. I mean, may well do. The World Health Organization has recommended that things below your per capita GDP should be regarded as cost effective. What the WHO recommend is three times your GDP per capita, it would be always cost ineffective. We couldn't possibly pay £60,000 per collie as a threshold. Couldn't possibly. We just couldn't afford it. We'd bankrupt the whole system. And one has to remember, whenever we say yes, there is almost inevitably a price that's paid. And it's not easy to capture, but for example, when we said yes to breast cancer, to Herceptin for breast cancer, one primary care trust had to close down its at-home palliative care service to fund it. You know, there's a price that's paid.
What would be the wait time for a knee replacement or a hip replacement for a 70-year-old male who's otherwise in good health right now?
Well, it would depend a bit where he lived, but it would be a month, 6 weeks, that sort of thing.
Any more questions? Okay. Well, thank you very much, Sir Michael. That was really fascinating.